and show us who we are in your love. Amen. So, welcome back to our weekly dose of practical theology. This week, love the sinner, hate the sin. We've been talking about these half-truths for the last few weeks, but it kind of seems to me that this week it's not just a half-truth. It's not leaving some important part out. It's adding something. Because y'all know me. If you have seen me even for 5 minutes, you know that love the sinner is right up my alley. And I believe it's also right up God's alley. But this love the sinner, hate the sin part, that sounds really off to me. And when things sound that far off, and people tell me it's about the Bible, my first thought is Leviticus. Now, Leviticus is a perfectly fine book of the Bible, and it has much wisdom for us, but it is also wildly misused, and it's wildly misused in inconsistent ways. So I thought, well, maybe that's where this one came from. And so I looked, and I found in Leviticus 19:17, which you heard just a few moments ago, you shall not hate in your heart anyone of your kin. You shall reprove your neighbor, or you will incur guilt yourself. Well, I guess maybe that's kind of close. Do not hate your kin. But who are our kin? Well, in reading the whole Bible, one of the things we see that our kin are our brothers and sisters in Christ. Not just blood family ties, although that might be part of it, but we have each other. We are kin to each other as the body of Christ. And we are not to hate one another. Ah, here it is. We can reprove one another. Oh, no, not one another. We can reprove a neighbor. Maybe that gives us an out from this loving and forgiving business. Reprove. It's to express disapproval. To express disapproval to our neighbors, which is to say, not our kin. Not to our brothers and sisters as the body of Christ. So maybe that means to not approve of the things they do wrong. Well, okay. But maybe disapproval isn't really the same as hate, though, is it? How many of you ever had a parent, you don't have to raise your hand, had a parent disapprove of something you did at some point in your life? Teenagers are all like, and yet, that disapproval did not mean they hated you. What it meant is that somebody's saying, hey, this path you're going on, this is not a good way to go. So even reproving comes about back to loving people. Because maybe your neighbors don't know. Maybe sometimes loving them enough to reach out to help them to get off of a bad path is inviting them to be part of the body of Christ. And once they're part of the body of Christ, you know what that makes them? Kin. Yep. And so, even reproving comes back around to love. So then in verse 18, we got to keep looking because clearly somebody thinks this hate and sin business is a good idea. You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against any of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. And then, the clicker. I am the Lord. So if you love your neighbor as yourself, then you're loving your neighbor as if they are already kin. Regardless of any reproving, loving them as if they are already part of the body of Christ. And just to make sure that we get it, God reminds us, I am the Lord. It's my body. I get to decide who is part of it. And I want you to bring folks from being reproved to being loved. So even those we reprove, it's to love them. Now, the half-truth does say, love the sinner. Yay! But we still have not gotten to the hate the sin part. And Leviticus doesn't tell us anything about how to feel about our neighbor, or even what to feel about what our neighbor did, or even, for that matter, doesn't tell us what to reprove. So how are we supposed to know? Are we supposed to sit around with a big spreadsheet and codes and laws and figure out the exact details of what is a sin and what isn't? Some of you may know that Jesus had some strong words for that for the people in the temple. They were taking dill seeds. And if you're a gardener, you may know that dill seeds are teeny tiny little things. And they were counting them, 9 for us, 1 for God. 9 for us, 1 for God. And Jesus said, no, that's not what I meant. Loving. That part where Jesus fulfilled the law for us, it means we do not have to keep score. We do not have to count out the dill seeds to make sure God gets enough and not one dill seed more. When we all become Him, when we were all part of the body of Christ, we are all baptized into that forgiveness that Jesus offers. We all get the fulfillment of the law that Jesus did. And what that means is the sins are all gone anyway. So if I'm hating something that is gone, that just does not seem like a good use of my time. It seems like, well, okay, so do you remember last week, loving takes a lot of time. We can say just love, but it is not an easy, quick matter. Once you get going on loving, it will easily take up every ounce of energy you have, and all of your time, but you will be energized by it. Because loving is fun. There's always someone else who needs love, and you can be the one to share it. And Leviticus had one more thing to say. Now this is back in verse 15. Hear that one today. You shall not render an unjust judgment, which to me says, I better be really, really, really careful about what I deem a sin. If I'm going to hate a sin, I better make sure that it is actually a sin. Because sometimes we get confused and we think that just because we don't like something, that it's a sin. But in reality, the discomfort of one person does not necessarily mean that another person is sinning. Just because you would never do something does not mean that someone else doing that thing is sinning. Take me, for example. There is at least one thing about my life that some of you would want no part of. It would be horrible for you. But does that make it a sin for me? I mean, I love steak, but some of you don't want anything to do with me. You say, no, we must be vegetarians. But does that mean I'm sinning? If eating steak separates me from God, then yes, it is sinning. But for me, I see the ribeye, no butter on top, and it's grilled, so that the fat is kind of soft and delicious. I eat that and I go, thanks be to God, this is delicious. It brings me closer to God. But what if a behavior does separate me from God? Well, the fact is, all the sins are forgiven. They're gone. Loving is the way we help each other get back on track when we go awry. Loving is how God moves us back into relationship, away from the effects of sin in our life. Like that dissolvable paper in the baptismal font, and I encourage you to take a peek in there when you go by, you cannot see what each of us has written down. It's not here anymore. Jesus took care of it when he lived and he died, and then he was resurrected. So loving means, in the words of Paul's letter to the Ephesians, to put away. Did you ever put something away in a really safe place and you still don't know where it is? That's how we're supposed to put away bitterness, wrath, anger, wrangling. I'm particularly fond of that, wrangling. Slander, malice, pack them up and put them away. Remember that the things that elicit those responses in you have been dissolved because Jesus lived and died and came back to live again. And then once you've packed up all that stuff, what should be left? Well, imitating God. A God who is kind and tender-hearted and forgiving. Because that is how God loves you. Kindly. With a tender heart. Oh, God says, aw. And always, always forgiving. This loving business means that when we are brokenhearted, because we've seen a video of some crying preschoolers crying in chain link cages in Texas or Arizona, we cannot waste our time hating whomever we decide to blame for it. We have to go out and love. That's our call. Find a way to love a child in need, even if that child is here in Raleigh instead of Texas. Even if that child is nothing like what you see in the news, find a way to love. We're also called, though, to search our hearts and find a way to love the people that we decide to blame for these problems. We have to do the hard work of figuring out what it means to love in that situation. We have to know also that when we just can't manage it, when the anger is too strong and the shame and the fear, God has forgiven us that too. Loving means that when we get in a fight with those who are closest to us, we remember how much we love them instead of how angry we are at something they've said or done. Our call is to do the hard work, and it is hard, of figuring out what it means to open ourselves up, to cope with the disappointment when loving doesn't feel like we think it should. So if you are upset about something in the news, anything, find a way to be kind, because that's how we fight the darkness. If you are angry enough to spit nails about someone that you also love fiercely, be tender-hearted. Remember the love. Let go of your rage. Move on to finding ways to demonstrate the love that is there. And when you find yourself having a hard time moving on, that would be me. Remember that God in Jesus saved you, saved me. That in Jesus, every single human being on this earth has access to full and free forgiveness, even if they aren't living into it yet. So love the sinner, yes, but don't hate the sin. Don't waste your time. Instead, remember forgiveness. Put away the sin. Go love. Amen.